Hello and welcome to the episode 89 of What a Fab Day. I am your host, Simon Mas. Today's highlights include a ghostwriting agreement, the shooting of the cover of Sgt Pepper's, and an unusual looping experiment by Phil Spector. As usual for the early days of the band, let's start with some live performances. On the 30th of March 1962, the Beatles, featuring Pete Best on drums, performed their 99th lunchtime concert and their 65th evening gig at the Cavern Club in Liverpool. It was the 25th time they had a double feature in a single day in that venue. 1 year later, in 1963, we have another two houses of the Beatles' Montez Row package tour at the Guildhall in Portsmouth. Beatles manager Brian Epstein had met Daily Express journalist Derek Taylor at the NEMS offices in Liverpool at some point in March 1964. Epstein had asked Taylor if he knew a writer that could ghostwrite his autobiography. After hearing what kind of person Epstein had in mind, he had to have a modern style of writing, he should be able to get on well with him, and ideally, he should be knowledgeable about the Beatles too, Taylor had proposed that he himself could do the job. Epstein had accepted and today, on the 30th of March 1964, sent to Taylor a check for £250, about £4,300 in 2020 money. By the end of his role as ghostwriter, Taylor would receive a further £650, about £11,200 in 2020 money, and a 2% cut off Epstein's earnings from the sales of the book, which would come out in 1964 with the title A Cellarful of Noise. And it seems the right time to remind you to please visit www.simonmas.com/support if you like this podcast and would like to do something to help me. Help me to do what? Why? To put out even more music-related series and to improve the quality of my work. You can be fab and really make the difference in a number of ways, from making a small donation, even just enough to buy me a coffee, to simply spreading the word about my content to your friends and, why not, to your enemies too. Thank you! On the 30th of March 1965, the Beatles had another day at the Twickenham Film Studios to continue the shooting for their second feature film, Eight Arms to Hold You, as Help was known at this stage of the production. Unusually though, after the end of the shooting session at 5:30 p.m, the Fabs reached Abbey Road, where they had an unproductive recording session. Starting from 7 p.m, they tried to re-record That Means a Lot, initially tackled in February, as detailed in episode 51 of What a Fab Day, abandoning the track after 5 unsatisfying takes, 3 of which incomplete. The track would remain unreleased until it surfaced in 1996 with its inclusion in the Anthology 2 album. After the attempt at remaking That Means a Lot was abandoned, the Beatles proceeded recording a number of overdubs on You're Going to Lose That Girl, none of which would be used in a final version of the song. They included a new guitar solo, bongos, and piano. The session was wrapped up at 10 p.m. Moving on to 1967, the Beatles began their day with a late afternoon visit at photographer Michael Cooper's studio at 4 Chelsea Manor Studios in Flood Street, London. The aim was to shoot the cover for their next album, Sgt Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band, designed by Peter Blake and his wife Jan Howarth. The set had been put together in the previous 8 days with the now world-famous assemblage of photos and statues featuring all kinds of famous people. The Beatles also posed for the pictures for the back cover and the gatefold sleeve of the album. The original idea for the cover, a presentation featuring famous people, a mayor, and the band, was Paul McCartney's, who had talked about it with his art dealer friend, Robert Fraser, who, in turn, had suggested Blake, Howarth, and Cooper to realize it. The entire cover art design and realization cost was £1,500 and 12 shillings, about £27,400 in 2020 money. After the photos were taken, the Beatles moved to the EMI studios where, starting at 11 p.m, they completed, with a little help from my friends, overdubbing lead guitar, bass, timpani, snare drum and tambourine, and a host of vocal parts, completing the work on the song at 7:30 a.m. Finally, in 1970, Phil Spector tried out an idea during one of the EMI studio sessions for his work on the Get Back tapes. He looped 16 seconds from the instrumental break of For Your Blue and added to it a number of dialogues from the unused Get Back session material. Several of the dialogue bits were used in the Let It Be film, but the piece was ultimately rejected by Spector himself. The only bit of dialogue from today's experiment heard in the final version of the album was John Lennon's "Queen Says No to Pot-Smoking FBI Members" introducing For Your Blue. And with this, I hereby declare that another episode of What a Fab Day has come to its end. Tune in tomorrow for the filming of the climax of A Hard Day's Night. For the moment, I wish you a good day and a fab continuation. Simon Mas, music you love.